morning students. In previous class, we discussed about Big Bang theory. So according to Big Bang theory, early atmosphere is totally filled with hydrogen and water vapors. Because of this decreasing of temperature, that water vapors have continuously fell as a rain. Because of that rain, all depressions of the earth is totally filled with rainy water. Now that water we are now termed as oceans. Now in that oceans, early life was formed according to Big Bang theory. So one of the famous scientists named as Haldane, that Haldane scientist given that oceanic water as hot dilute soup. And this soup is also termed as prebiotic soup. So according to that Haldane scientist, the first life was occurred in that water only. Now, like that first life was occurred in that ocean, such type of life arises 500 million years after the formation of Earth. So already we know the age of Earth is about 4.5 billion years. 4.5 billion years. So this is the age of Earth. After the formation of Earth, after 500 million years, the first life where arises on this earth according to Big Bang theory. Now this is equivalent to 4 billion years back. So 4 billion years back, the first life arises in this earth according to Big Bang theory. Now after the Big Bang theory, the next conjectured story. Already we know conjectured, nothing but guess stories, there is no practical proofs. Such type of stories are termed as conjectured stories. Then the second conjectured story is known as panspermia theory. This panspermia theory is also known as cosmozoic theory. The other name for this panspermia theory is also known as cosmozoic theory. Here, cosmos. The meaning of cosmos is universe. So here cosmos means universe. From that universe, life is arises according to this theory. Now this theory states, for example, after the formation of all these solar systems, all these galaxies. So see here, this is our solar system is like this. Different types of planets, they are circulating around the Sun in their axis. Now this is our solar system. So according to panspermia theory, they are saying like this, from this universe, from this space, the life is transferred in the form of spores. Now these are all spores. So according to this panspermia theory, life in the form of spores. Here, these spores are also termed as units of life. These units of life are also called as spores, are also known as panspermias. So such type of spores were distributed through each and every planet. Now such type of spores were coming from universe, from the sky, from the space. Once these spores are transported to each and every planet, they are finally distributed to each and every planet in our solar system. Not only in our solar system, in each and every solar, in each and every galaxies. So all these spores there are transported to the different types of planets, including our Earth. For example, this is our Earth. Including this Earth also, such type of spores are transferred. Once these spores reaches to the Earth, in this earth, in this planet only, life is arises. It means each and every spore, once they reaches to the earth, they evolved into a type of organisms. So in our earth, up to now 1.7 billion of different types of organisms were discovered by scientists. Now each and every organism arises in this earth because of a type of spore. For example, human beings are arises because of a spore is coming from the space. Some animals are coming because of like that spores. So each and every spore is responsible for the formation of a type of organism. No, according to panspermia theory. Now, still, this theory is accepted by some astronomers. Here, astrology, the study of stars, the study of planets is known as astrology. And the scientists, those are famous in that course, such type of scientists we are termed as astronomers. So still some astronomers are strongly believing such type of theory. Okay, this is about panspermia theory. It is also known as cosmos-like theory. Here cosmos is nothing but universe. From that universe, spores are transported to different types of planets, including our Earth. And this is also not accepted by majority of the scientists except astronomers. And this theory is also strongly believing some Greek thinkers. Still now, Greek thinkers are strongly believing such type of panspermia theory. Along with that, Greek thinkers, astronomers are also giving support for this theory. But scientists, they are not accepting. And after this panspermia theory, then the third theory is known as spontaneous generation theory. Spontaneous generation theory. This spontaneous generation theory is also known as abiogenesis theory. Abiogenesis theory. Now, according to this, already we know the meanings. Bio means life, abio means there is no life. So, according to spontaneous generation theory, here living organisms are coming from rotting and decaying matter. From this rotting and decaying matter, if life is arises, so such type of theories are known as spontaneous generation theory, also known as abiogenesis theory. This theory states that if life is coming from dead and decaying matters, so such type of theory is known as spontaneous generation theory. Examples given here, straw and mud. Here, straw is nothing but stalk of the leaf. This is called a stalk. That stalk is also, especially in scientific terminology, this is called as a stalk. This stalk giving support to the leaf. Once this leaf is fell down from the tree, then immediately what happens? They are going to decay. Such type of decaying stalks, especially termed as straws, from that straws and mud, man in your language. From that mud, different types of living organisms are arises, according to spontaneous generation theory. Now this theory was strongly believed by Aristotle. Tales, Plato, like this, very famous scientists. On that time, well-famous scientists, Aristotle, Thales, Plato, all these scientists, they were also believed strongly this theory. Why? Because when we observe the mud, generally, now we know that the habitat of frog, but on that day, in 18th century, in 17th century, they don't know the habitats of living organisms. So, when we observe the frogs, the frog habitat is inside of the mud, nearer to the water bodies. So they thought that once the frog is coming from that mud, they thought that mud is only generating frog, like that. Like this, some examples given from a Nile River. River form we know, the rivers are like this. From that rivers, snakes are arises. So if any dead animals which we are seeing, after some days, if one dog is dead, automatically what happened? After some days, on that dead body, some white colored worms will develop. So on that day, they believed that all these white colored or some other organisms and some other insects, all these organisms are produced by that dead organism only. So, according to this theory, dead organisms, decaying organisms, they are producing living organisms. So, such type of theory was strongly believed by Aristotle, Thales and Plato or some other scientists. They given here examples, straw and mud. From these decaying and rotting substances, life arises. This is also not accepted by majority. And after that, biogenesis theory. This biogenesis theory was given by Louis Pasteur. So this Louis Pasteur does not accept a spontaneous generation theory. He strongly disproved spontaneous generation theory. He does not believe this theory. So after that, Louis Pasteur given one more theory known as biogenesis theory. So according to biogenesis theory, life comes only from pre-existing life. Pre-existing living organisms only produces living organisms. So that statement was given by Louis Pasteur. Now the theory is known as biogenesis theory. This biogenesis theory is quite opposite to spontaneous generation theory. So here, what is this spontaneous generation theory? If life is coming from dead and decaying substances, that is known as spontaneous. According to biogenesis theory, if life arises from pre-existing life, that is called as biogenesis theory. For this, he given one of the experimental proof. For this experiment, he taken two flasks. Now, such type of flask. Now, these flasks are of pre-sterilized. So, he taken pre-sterilized flask. They taken only two different pre-sterilized flasks. So already we know the shape of this flask is like this. Now those are of pre-sterilized. In this sterilization mechanism, what happened? They are heating such type of flask. While heating, what happened? If any microbial organisms are there inside of the flask, all these microbial organisms were died by heating. Now that process is known as a sterilization process. Now, he taken two pre-sterilized flasks like this. Now, in first flask, he taken one of the killed yeast like this. He taken one of the killed yeast. So, according to abiogenesis theory, this killed yeast is a dead and decaying organism. Right, is it? Now, for that purpose, he taken one of the pre-sterilized flasks. In that, no microbial organisms are there. Then immediately he taken a killed yeast and immediately he closed that flask with a tube. That tube is totally covered with a cap. Means there is no entry of air, there is no entry of foreign materials. So according to abiogenesis theory, what happened? This killed yeast is one of the decaying matter. So according to abiogenesis theory, this killed yeast, this decaying substances is producing living organisms. So Louis Pasteur does not accept the theory, and for that purpose he taken one of the flask, and in that flask he taken killed yeast, and finally he closed that flask with a tube and with a cap. And finally he observed this flask up to several months, and while closing this flask, there is no production of living organisms in this flask. Why? Because see here, second time he taken same pre-sterilized flask. Into that he is taken same killed yeast, but this time he closed that tube with the same like this tube, but this time the tube is not covered with the cap. In first experiment he covered with the cap, but in second experiment he does not covered with cap. Then what happened here? For this, there is an easy entry of air and foreign materials. So, and finally he observed this experiment after several months, and he observed here the formation of microbial organisms. Same killed yeast, same flask, here they are covering with cap, but here they are open to air. In this experiment, he observed the formation of microbial organisms. This indicates killed yeast is not producing any living organisms. Means abiogenesis theory is wrong. Now here, once the flask is open to air, Here, inside of these plants, there is a formation of microbial organisms. This indicates killed yeast is not producing any living organisms. That living organisms are coming from outside of the flask. So now finally this experiment is termed as swan neck flask experiment. Swan neck flask experiment. Why? Because for this flask, the neck is exactly like a swan. Swan is nothing but one of the bird. That bird neck is also like this. That's why this experiment name is totally termed as swan neck flask experiment. This swan neck flask experiment explains us life is coming from pre-existing living organisms only, and life is not coming from dead and decaying matter. That's why spontaneous generation theory was disproved by Louis Pasteur. So this biogenesis theory was given by Louis Pasteur. This is somewhat accepted by scientists. Now, three conjectured stories completed. After that, one more theory, one very well famous theory known as chemical evolution theory. In first one, Big Bang theory. After Big Bang theory, panspermia. After panspermia, abiogenesis theory, also known as spontaneous generation. And after that, biogenesis theory. And finally, and next one is, sorry, fifth one is chemical evolution theory. This is one of the famous majority of the scientists accepted this theory. And finally, the theory is known as chemical evolution theory. Now, this theory was given by two scientists. One is Oparin and one is Haldane. Oparin and Haldane. Here, Oparin from Russia and Haldane is from England. Oparin from Russia and Haldane from England. Both together given one of the theory known as chemical evolution theory. Now, according to this chemical evolution theory, life arises from pre-existing non-living organic molecules. Life came from pre-existing non-living organic molecules. So according to abiogenesis theory, life is coming from decaying and rotting matter. According to biogenesis theory, life is coming from pre-existing life. But here, according to chemical evolution theory, life is coming from pre-existing organic molecules. Examples for these organic molecules, RNA and proteins. These RNA and proteins are of organic molecules, and such type of organic molecules are of non-living organic molecules. From that organic molecules, life arises according to chemical evolution theory. And here one doubt, how these organic molecules were arises? Now they given one of the conclusion, all these organic molecules came from inorganic constituents. So organic molecules are coming from inorganic molecules. Inorganic molecules are modified into organic. Then from these organic molecules, life arises. Now this is according to chemical evolution theory. Along with this statement, they also given early earth conditions. Early earth conditions, almost all equivalent to Big Bang theory. So according to this chemical evolution theory, the early earth conditions are of where temperature was more. Next, the total earth is covered with volcanic stromes. For example, this is one of the earth. The total atmosphere, already you know, according to Big Bang theory, the total atmosphere is filled with hydrogen. If hydrogen is filling, the type of atmosphere is termed as reducing atmosphere. Now present day atmosphere is totally filled with oxygen. Instead of oxygen, in early earth, the total atmosphere was filled with hydrogen. Now this is hydrogen according to Big Bang theory. But here chemical evolution theory, they given as reducing atmosphere. And this is totally earth. Now this total earth surface is filled with volcanic stromes. Now according to your language, volcanic stromes nothing but Jwalamukhi. Now the total earth surface is filled with volcanic stromes. Because of that there was a more temperature, and along with this the main and important chemicals are methane and ammonia. The total atmosphere and earth consists of mainly two types of chemicals, namely methane and ammonia. According to Big Bang theory, early earth chemicals are methane, ammonia is common in chemical evolution theory and Big Bang theory. Along with this, water in the form of vapors, along with that carbon dioxide. Now all these four chemicals were present on earth surface according to Big Bang theory. But here, according to chemical evolution theory, earth consists of mainly two types of chemicals named as methane and ammonia. So these are all points given by Oparin and Haldane. Now this theory is known as chemical evolution theory, and this theory was accepted by majority of the scientists accepted this theory. Now once again, chemical evolution theory states that life is coming from pre-existing non-living organic molecules. Now these non-living organic molecules, examples are of RNA and proteins. Now these organic molecules were coming from inorganic substances. Along with that statement, they given also some statements. Earlier conditions where temperature was more, because of total earth is surrounded with volcanic stromes. Along with that, the total atmosphere is in the form of reducing, means total atmosphere is filled with hydrogen. That's why it is called as reducing atmosphere. Along with that, methane and ammonia. Now these are all statements given by Oparin and Haldane. The theory is known as chemical evolution theory. For this chemical evolution theory, S.L. Miller in 1981, he conducted one of the experiment in laboratory scale. In this experiment, see here, S.L. Miller conducted this experiment. In this experiment, he taken one of the closed flasks. In that closed flask, he provided two electrodes. Along with these electrodes, he taken mainly four types of chemicals. Why he conducted this experiment? Because this experiment is giving support to the chemical evolution theory, along with that Big Bang theory also. How life is arises, how life starts from pre-existing life, like this. For that purpose, he conducted one of the experiment. This experiment is giving support to the majorly chemical evolution theory and Big Bang theory. Now, according to Big Bang theory, already we know water vapors are reacted with UV rays. Once UV rays are reacting with water vapors, that water vapors are splits into hydrogen and oxygen. The free oxygens are interacting with ammonia, methane and carbon dioxide, and they forms some other chemicals. Now for that purpose, he taken some chemicals, namely methane, ammonia, water vapors and hydrogen gas. Now these are all gases taken in this closed flask. Which type of chemicals? Once again, methane, ammonia, water in the form of vapors and hydrogen. This is according to S.L. Miller. So here, according to Big Bang, the four types of chemicals are of methane, ammonia, water vapors and carbon dioxide. In case of chemical evolution, which type of chemicals? Methane and ammonia. And in case of S.L. Miller experiment, four types of chemicals: methane, ammonia, water in the form of vapors and hydrogen. See, these are all variations. Among all these theories, the common chemicals are of methane and ammonia, common chemicals. So he taken all these gases in a closed flask. Along with these gases, he provided two electrodes. One end of this flask is connected with one more flask. Now this flask is consists of totally boiling water. In this flask, totally boiling water is there. Here, they raises the temperature up to 800 degrees centigrade. 800 degrees centigrade. Already we know the boiling point of the water. Once the temperature reaches up to 100 degrees centigrade, immediately the water exhibit boiling. Now, because of that boiling, what happened here? The liquid form of water is going converted into vaporized form. So, for this purpose, he taken one more flask. In that flask, he taken water and the temperature raises up to 800 degrees centigrade. Now, this gaseous flask is connected with the water, boiling water flask. Another end of this flask is connected with the condenser. Now this is condenser. Now this condenser consists of two openings. In this, through one opening, water is going inside, and through another opening, water is coming outside. This is for water inlet, this is for water outlet. Now this total tube is termed as condenser. Okay, there is no connection for this flask and this condenser. Simply from outside they created this condenser. Why they created? Because of for cooling purpose, for cooling of this tube. The tube is going inside of this condenser. Okay, there is no connection for this condenser and this inner tube. And finally, this flask tube is connected with a U-trap. This is U-trap. And this U-trap is also connected with the boiling flask. Now all this arrangement he created inside of the laboratory. And why he created such type of arrangement? Because he created early earth conditions. Whatever the conditions were present in early earth, same conditions he created inside of the laboratory. Now finally, this S.L. Miller experiment. S.L. Miller experiment is simply called as simulation experiment. Simulation experiment. Here simulation. Simulation is nothing but equivalent. Equivalent. So he created equivalent environment. So here, see, all these gases he taken in this flask. Now all these gases are equivalent to Big Bang theory. The next, he created electrodes. Now these electrodes are equivalent to UV rays. UV rays. And here he created boiling flask and he raises the temperature up to 800 degrees centigrade. This is an equivalent condition of early earth temperature. Early earth temperature is about 5000 degrees centigrade to 6000 degrees centigrade. For that purpose, he created like this arrangement. And here, he created condenser. He arranged a condenser. This condenser is for cooling purpose. Now, this condenser is equivalent to rain. Rain. So, like this arrangements created inside of the laboratory. So, here, While boiling the water, that water vapors are going like this, and finally that water vapors once enters into this spark chamber. Now this chamber is termed as spark discharge. Whatever the gases are present, all these gases consist of this terminal. All are present in this chamber. That's why this is called as a spark chamber or spark discharge. Once the water, especially water in the form of vapors, that water vapors enters into this spark discharge. Here, he arranged electrodes. Once water vapors enters into this spark chamber, because of these electrodes, what happened? These are equivalent to UV rays. That electrodes, because of that spark, water vapors are going to split. Same like that earlier environment. So that hydrogen is separated and oxides are separated. The free oxides are easily reacting with methane and ammonia and they forms other chemicals. Okay. Now, he taken here maximum inorganic chemicals. ammonia, water and hydrogen. Only one organic molecule taken, that is methane. So according to chemical evolution theory, all these inorganic molecules, they interact with each other. While interacting, they are forming other organic molecules. Like that, all these organic molecules interact and finally forms life. So here, once the water vapors enters into this spark discharge, water is going to split in the form of hydrogen and oxides. Now these free oxides are easily interacting with remaining chemicals like methane and ammonia and others, and they are forming some other molecules. Now all these molecules finally reaches to the U-trap. Now this is U-trap. Like this experiment conducted for some days by S.L. Miller. After some days, while collecting the samples, while collecting the fluid from this U-trap, he identified for the formation of amino acids. Finally, he identified the formation of amino acids. Especially, the early amino acids are of alanine, glycine, aspartic acid. Alanine, glycine, aspartic acid. Like these amino acids, simple amino acids, he identified in this fluid. All these amino acids were formed because of interaction of these chemicals. Already we know these amino acids are of structural and functional units of proteins. Now, S.L. Miller conducted this experiment only for some days. And finally, some other scientists, they conducted this experiment, same experiment for several months. And after collecting this fluid, they identified the formation of sugars, the formation of fats, pigments and nitrogen bases. Understood? Same experiment conducted by other scientists. S.L. Miller conducted this experiment only for several days. In that days only, he identifies the formation of amino acids. Same experiment was conducted by other scientists for several months. While observing this fluid, that scientist were identified the formation of sugars, the formation of fats, pigments and nitrogen bases. See here, sugars, carbohydrates. These are the simplest form of carbohydrates. Here, the simplest form of proteins, means proteins were formed. The next, sugars, nothing but carbohydrates were also formed. And fats, lipids. All these chemicals were formed. How these chemicals were formed? Proteins, carbohydrates and lipids. Because the interaction of these chemicals. Here, S.L. Miller taken majority of inorganic chemicals. So, this experiment is giving support to the chemical evolution theory. Means, from inorganic chemicals, organic molecules were formed. Now, these are all organic molecules. Along with these lipids, pigments were also formed. Pigments, chlorophyll, hemoglobin, these are all comes under pigments. Along with that pigments, nitrogen bases, adenine, guanine, thymine, cytosine, uracil. Like that, nitrogen bases were also identified in this fluid. So what happened here? Adenine, guanine, thymine, cytosine, like these nitrogen bases are there. Now all these nitrogen bases, along with these phosphates and sugars. Sugars were also formed. If a nitrogen base and a sugar, if both are arranged, means what happened here? A nitrogen base and a pentose sugar. This structure together called as nucleoside. Nucleoside means sugar and a nitrogen base. Both these two structures together called as nucleosides. Along with these nucleosides, if inorganic phosphate is combined, automatically what happens? There is the formation of nucleotide. Now these nucleotides are the structural units of DNA and RNA. Like this, DNA and RNA, nothing but life forms. Like this, life forms were arises by the interaction of all these chemicals. Now, this theory is known as S.L. Miller experiment, also called as simulation experiment. Now, this theory is giving support to the chemical evolution theory as well as Big Bang theory. That's why, now Big Bang theory is just guessing story. It is also like guess, but practical proofs are there. That's why chemical evolution theory was accepted by majority of the scientists. Okay, thank you.